This week, three sides of the coin. You've been asking. You've wanted it.
Mark is not here.
Wasn't going there, but that works. A Mark St. John special episode. All Mark St. John.
This is Three Sides of the Coin, talking all things KISS.
I want to rock and roll all night.
You're listening to Three Sides of the Coin.
So you love the show. Go to itunes.threesidesofthecoin.com and leave your review and rating of Three Sides of the Coin. Thanks.
Everybody, welcome back to another episode of Three Sides of the Coin. I am one of your three co-hosts, Michael Brandvold. And as always, I'm joined by Tommy Summers and the lovely Mark Cicchini.
I'm so happy I got to speak this week.
You did. You were able to say a few words, Tommy.
Yes, it's a miracle.
I'm just, you know, Mark, Ken, it's sometimes it's beautiful to look at you at this show. Other times it's rough to look at you.
Oh Lord, here we go again.
No, obviously Mark is not with us. He is
on tour with White Lion.
He's actually auditioning for White Lion. Kid you not.
Or Trickster.
Or Trickster, one of those two bands. You know, a gig's a gig, and opportunity's an opportunity, as we learn.
All for the love of rock and roll.
In this week's episode, it's all about the opportunity. So you might see Mark Cicchini on drums with Trickster.
Exactly. So make sure you get your lighters out when the Children Cry starts playing. Someone posted
them. When That's the meat awesome. When the meatloaf cries is what somebody
when, no when the meatloaf burns.
All right, let's do a little housekeeping. So housekeeping. Are you gonna come to Minnesota?
I'm thinking about it.
She's thinking.
What's it take to make that thinking yes?
I don't know.
I don't know. Come on, Tommy. Let's see those moves. Make her come out to Minnesota.
She's invited. She knows that.
Hey, you never know. I'll just show up.
Well, we got to put you on the guest list. Otherwise, we may not have enough room.
Yeah. I see how it is. I'll be knocking on the window.
Well, and speaking of that, we probably should shift the time a little because I'm already getting people bitching at me that they want to go and can't go at 3 o'clock in the afternoon because they're still at work.
Well, here's what I envision. We're going to record the show at 3 because Mark has to record at 3 o'clock because that's his normal recording time. But we'll stay around and hang around there after that's done.
Yeah.
Until, I don't know, whenever time Heavy Metal Grill closes.
Okay. That's fair.
Unless you think we can get Mark to record later at night.
Well, Mark maybe should just come over there.
I know.
If I'm going to come from the ATL, he needs just to come over.
Yeah, please. Detroit, that's just a hop, skip, and a jump.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I'd like but to see Mark hop, skip, and jump.
Well, and if Lisa's coming, Mark will probably show up, you know. Take something like that to get him.
Yeah, he wouldn't do it just for you and me, would he?
No. Not at all. He's got zero interest in that.
He sees us Weisenheimers every week. No. Yeah. Lisa, you have to say yes, and then we can get Mark to come.
Yeah, all we'll right. work on it. We'll work on it.
But okay. July 12th, Lakeville, Minnesota, Heavy Metal Grill. We're going to be out there, going to try and record a show. We're going to hang around, eat some Three Sides of the Coin appetizers, drink.
And it's a bar that serves incredible food that plays rock music all day long. It's a great concept, and Marty's a good guy. It's a Heavy Metal Grill, and it's very nice of Marty to want to host this for us, so thank you, Marty, if you're listening. We'll have space for everybody that wants to show up. The last one last year at Joe Sensor's was a lot of fun. We had probably, 30 people, I think, show up. So I'd love to see even more this time.
We ate meatloaf.
We ate meatloaf. We had, we had the christening. And for those people that don't know, the Heavy Metal Grill is about 30 minutes south of downtown Minneapolis and downtown St. Paul.
Very easy to get to. Straight down 35W.
Yep, or 35E, depending on where you're coming from.
Yeah, so it's not like it's going to be difficult to get there and find it. Anyway, we'll keep you posted as to whether Lisa's going to show up and whether Mark will then finally show up.
Yes, ultimately.
I need to...
You know what? We should just tell them that there's like a swingers thing going on right before.
How did I know that was going to be brought up? I was going to mention, but that's okay.
That'll do it.
Oh, you're so bad. I want to do a special thank you to one of our listeners. We've read a letter from this guy before. Steve Stumpy Grossi.
Okay.
He sent me a package and a little card in here that said, Mike, recently came across these, thought they were pretty cool. Unfortunately, I had to buy a full bag of 10. What the hell? What the hell am I going to do with 10? So I've sent along 4 bags, one each for you, Mark, Tommy, and Lisa. Aww. Do with them what you will. Recent shows have been great. Thanks, Steve Stumpy Grossi.
Thanks,
so
Steve. That's very nice
sent
of you.
Us.
Aw, that
these
was
are,
nice
these
of
are
him.
These are empty bags, coffee bags from KISS
Coffee. Oh, nice. Very cool.
So
thank you very much.
4 of them, one for each of us. So, Tommy, you'll get yours when I come to Minnesota. Lisa, okay. I'll give you yours when you come to Minnesota. And, Mark, you won't get yours until you come to Minnesota.
Perfect. We can take them to a Twins game and make them root for one of our teams.
Yeah.
It'll be great.
No, these are really nice.
Yeah, those are really cool. That was very thoughtful. Thank you
much. No coffee in them. They're empty. So, thank you.
That's collector's
Steve.
Item.
Collector's items. Thank you, mm-hmm. Steve. The other thing I want to do is I want to make my plug for...
Please,
people. We've talked about Cheap Trick many times on this show. This is the new album, Bang Zoom Crazy Hello. Oh, it frickin' rocks.
Yes, I will even go out on a limb here and say that the song No Direction Home could very well end up being one of my favorite Cheap Trick songs of all time, right up there with Up the Creek.
We've talked about maybe doing a whole track by track review of this on Three Sides. I know I would. I know you.
Can we
want
do a
to.
Cheap Trick day? Yeah, let's do a Cheap Trick day.
Maybe if Mark doesn't want to do it, we kick him out and we have Lisa join us.
There you go.
Because I would love to do a track by track of this.
Mm-hmm.
I have yet to hear it. Oh, goodness.
Shame.
Oh, get it. It's.
I'll listen to it.
It has classic Cheap Trick sounds everywhere. And
there's
no ballad to be found anywhere on this. No flame anywhere on here.
No flame.
Thank you, God. Well, because you just don't know what you're going to get, you know? And so I was so happy that they didn't shift back to that thing, whatever it was. So, yeah, I think we should do something like that.
I would love to. Anyway, go get this, people. If you want a great rock album, you want to support a band that's still releasing music, go pick up the new Cheap Trick album.
That actually play their own instruments and write their own songs. You know,
so unheard of these days.
I know. That's why it's so special.
You know what's very cool is my friend, who you guys know, Lee Westy. She is
a huge Tommy Thayer fan.
The biggest ever. She's not even going to see Ace tonight.
She's putting on Tommy Thayer's makeup to go see Ace.
Right now. Right now. She's on her way there.
It's going to piss her off, isn't it?
She does. She's in a tribute. She's in a Cheap Trick tribute band.
Oh my God! They look amazing.
Did you see? Have you heard? Have you seen some of the YouTube? They do "Hello Goodbye" from. They do a whole Beatles set in the Sergeant Pepper's outfit. Amazing.
Where are they located?
Here in Atlanta.
Phenomenal.
The Dream Police.
The Dream Police. Okay, all right.
Barry, did you see them, Mike? Did you see the pictures?
I've seen multiple pictures. I mean, I've seen the pictures of the Sgt. Pepper's outfits. I've seen their regular Cheap Trick outfit.
Right.
I mean, they went all out for outfits,
it's spot on.
Guitars,
staging.
Oh, it's like they put some time and money into it, big time.
I love that.
Well, it's the lead singer's name's Curtis Clark, and he really, when he does something, he just doesn't do it half-assed. He does it 100%. He has like that KISS mentality. You do either 100% or you don't do it at all. So he really did a really good job on that. I didn't go, but my husband went, and he loved it. So I didn't go though, because I actually went to see Mr. Speed in the afternoon. So I wore out my.
That was pretty cool. Those photos were great. I'd love to see him. Now, is Mr. Speed also from the Atlanta area?
Mr. Speed started in Pittsburgh. I was actually at their very first show, and I got them kind of I kind of got them not started, but I got them a couple good radio shows and a couple good gigs out in Pittsburgh because I worked at a radio station. So anytime someone's going to come to me and say, I want to put a KISS tribute band together in Pittsburgh, I'm going to be your biggest fan. I'm going to do everything I can to get you going. So I have their very first video of them playing in suits and ties because they didn't have costumes yet. So I go way back with Mr. Speed. So I always tell Rich, I'm like a proud mom. You know, I see how far they've come from 1993 and 94, and they're the best tribute band in the world. So I told him, I'm like a proud mom. But it was good seeing Rich and Jimmy Seda and Joe and Andrew. It was good to hang out with them and see them play here in Atlanta. So
that's what I did. Excellent.
Yeah, it was good times.
I wish they would come to Minneapolis. That'd be cool.
I'm surprised they don't. I mean, it's only a hop, skip, and a jump from Cleveland. So that's where Rich lives now.
Yeah, I don't recall them coming to the area, but I would support them and help them out if I could.
Absolutely. So. If Mr. Speed comes in the area, please go see them. They're a good bunch of guys, and go support.
So, okay. Tommy, do you have any comments to read this week?
Well, you know, I was expecting some more anger.
I think the problem is Ace's album is not out yet, so it's hard to get pissed at our review until they can say, I've listened to it and you're wrong.
Oh, not my review, just your review. Not even Mark's review, even though yours and Mark's are almost identical. You're still the villain.
It just killed me, the one guy who said your reviews were pretty much spot on. Tommy loved it. Mark was just middle of the road, and Mike, you hated it. And I was just like, I swear to God, Mark and I on many occasions were like identical in what we were saying.
Right. So I do have one, and this is off of YouTube, and it's JarJohn76, and he says, nice in-depth interview, guys. Oftentimes I scratch my head at Tommy's musical taste, but I respect his opinions. We like what we like. I appreciate the objectivity of the album, and I can't wait to hear it. I especially can't wait to hear Fire and Water and Rock and Roll Hell.
There you go.
Yeah.
I thought Emerald was great. I heard that, and I heard Parasite. And what was that other one that just came out? I can't think of the name for the life of me. But anyway, pardon me?
Emerald?
No, not Emerald, not Parasite.
Oh, very the Cream song.
Thank you. That's the one. Yes. White Room.
Well, I'll be curious to hear what he plays tonight because I heard he's been playing Emerald.
I know, and I'm very excited because I do. I think he did a great job on that song. I love Thin Lizzy, so I'm anxious to hear it.
And where are you seeing him?
I'm going to see him this evening. I'll be leaving as soon as I get off this bar stool. I've changed my shirt first, but I'm going to see him at the Variety Playhouse.
Okay, and is that like a standing room only kind of thing, or is it seats, or is it okay?
There's seats, but they're not assigned. It's general admission. It's like an old theater, so it's like the cushiony seats, but you know, you just kind of stand. Some of the seats are ripped out, so so perfect. Jeff Tate goes on at 8, and then Ace goes on after.
Sorry, man.
Yeah, I know. I want to get down there early because I want to see some of my friends, but I could really you know, bypass the Jeff Tate.
Are you doing the Ace meet and greet?
No.
Boy, that's an interesting answer.
Well, we should probably
I'm going to see some friends. So I have some friends that are down there. So we'll see what pans out.
Tommy, do you want to set Lisa up?
Yeah, I'll try. I'll do my best.
Say that three sides of the coin's in the house.
Yeah. See what I can do.
Look at Tommy working his magic.
He's the man. He's the man. All right. Well, Tommy's working his magic. So
yeah,
we have a special guest joining us this week. This is somebody that I first had contact with back in 86, I'm guessing, when I was doing college radio. And this album called White Tiger was released. And I had to play it on my metal show because it was a KISS-related album because it featured Mark St. John. We are joined by Eddie Coralnick, who has a long history with Mark St. John. Former manager, was the record label EMC Records, knew Mark pre-KISS, through KISS, post-KISS. He's coming on here to talk to us and fill us in as to who Mark was and what was going on through all those times, because there's really nobody out there who can talk about that anymore. I mean, obviously Mark is gone. Today is the 9th anniversary of Mark St. John's passing. He was 51 years old when he passed away in 2007. So, you know, obviously Mark can't say anything about what it was like to be with KISS. And Eddie's probably the closest person who was through all of that. And he's got some stories that he's going to share with us. Really, I don't know, it was about almost 90 minutes of talking about Mark St. John. I mean, we've had people ask us to do a Mark St. John's show. And it's sort of like, up until now, it's like, I don't know what to say.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, what can we say? Yeah, he was on one album, didn't tour, nobody knew him. That would be the extent of our show. So thankfully, Eddie showed up, and we've got a 90-minute show all about Mark St. John.
Very interesting.
So keep the play button going. Stick with Eddie, and you're going to get some insights into Mark St. John.
Take three sides of the coin with you anywhere. Download your 5-star rated free smartphone app today and listen on your Android or Apple smartphone. Visit android.threesidesofthecoin.com or ios.threesidesofthecoin.com.
So we at Three Sides are really happy to welcome Eddie Coralnick to the show. Eddie has a long history with Mark St. John. Let's just say this is going to be the Mark St. John episode of Three Sides of the Coin. And frankly, I don't know if any other podcast, anybody has ever done a Mark St. John special, mainly because there just hasn't been a lot of information out about Mark. But Eddie goes way back with Mark, pre-KISS, through KISS, post-KISS. Eddie, you were Mark's former manager. You set up EMC Records, which was the record label that White Tiger was on. So you've got a lot of history with Mark.
That is correct. And I'd like to get it straight to what anybody wants to know about my dear deceased friend, Mark.
So, you know what? I don't know if you might be aware. Today is the 9th anniversary of Mark's passing. As we are recording this today, he passed away 9 years ago.
Is it today?
It is today. Yes.
Wow.
So
April 5th, 2007.
Yep. 9 years ago.
Do you know who passed away today, too?
Who?
Or actually, the guy from Nirvana.
Oh, yes. Kurt Cobain.
And the guy, also the other guy from the other grunge band up there.
Lane Staley.
That is correct.
Yes. They passed away on this day as well. Well, so let's just go back to pre-KISS. I mean, tell us a little bit about Mark's pre-KISS history. What was he into? What got him started in music? What kind of person was he?
Well, Mark started playing guitar, which I saw in backyard clubs and parties, or not clubs, but parties in the early 70s, you know, and he was 15. And he taught his brother bass to play the bass. So it was him and his brother always teaming up. So it was that for years and years and years and years. Right around 1980, kind of got into going out to nightclubs, kind of broke up with a girlfriend, went to nightclubs. I walked into this nightclub, and there's this guy playing this double neck, SG, like Jimmy Page. Here he is, he's playing it, he's throwing it around, he's playing it like a potato. I mean, this guy is really incredible. And he's playing top 40. And back in the 80s, there was no DJs at a club, only between the sets of the music, you know, and that's what, it's a time frame. Like now, it's just like really different. But back in those days, when I started working with Mark, I walked into a nightclub, went to the soundboard and asked the guy, who's the masked man on the double neck? And the guy stuck his hand out, and that's Gordon Davis, my partner with EMC Records, who also was my partner working with Alan Holdsworth. And he ended up doing a lot of working with Alan Holdsworth, doing a lot of road work, mixing. Gordon grew up with Mark around the corner, and they grew up together. And it was Mark and Gordon and his brother, and it was all about music. Music, music, music. Mark said, if you can learn every Beatles tune, the whole catalog, you can play anything. So Mark, this is what Mark told me. He says, that's where he started. And when he played guitar, he learned all the Beatles songs. Then he really got into jazz music and fusion music. And back in those days, it was a lot different. KISS was part of it. I mean, you know, KISS was everywhere. You couldn't get a turn on the radio, it's KISS, you know. Not that, when I heard on the last interview thing you did, it's like Mark didn't like KISS. Well, Mark was not going to go home and listen to KISS. Sure, Mark liked KISS. Mark wouldn't have went to New York if he didn't really like KISS to start, but he didn't know. It's was like, hey, it's opportunity. But Mark, in the days of the nightclubs, he'd teach music all day at Lear's Music in Garden Grove, and then he'd go to the nightclubs, and then after the nightclubs, he'd sit there and practice, and we start building equipment. Trying to get some demos going. We went over to Orange Studio. It's the city of Orange, and we just started building music. Mark, it was always an athletic guy. All he ever did was play basketball, I do believe. He was his whole family, they're all tall. So him and his brother, it was the basketball thing. And he was an athletic guy. That's why Mark was really involved in being kind of a performer. Let's go there. But Mark's whole thing was teach all day. He had a very large, he had, I don't know, 25 students. He'd rotate them all week long, play the nightclubs. There's giant circuit here in Orange County. He'd go to L.A. County, and that's where he started doing. Started getting pretty popular with this band called Front Page. The band members from his band, his keyboard player, Phil Christian, went to Cheap Trick. Mark DeBay, the drummer, went to Survivor. So all his band members started going places. So all of a sudden, it's like, wow, Mark's going, well, when do I get to go? But anyway, the whole thing is, our motto is, we're going to go to the forum. And what I did was put together a bunch of music, did some photography and put together a bio. And a good friend of mine, Grover Jackson, Jackson Guitars. Mark's first offer, and he went through Grover, they knew they were looking, but they were 2 weeks late for the Aussie gig and was going to be trying to get that gig, but Jakey Lee got the gig. So Grover goes.
This was post Randy Rhoads for the Aussie gig.
This was after Randy Rhoads.
Right, post. After Randy Rhoads.
I'm sorry. Yes, correct. So Grover goes up. Jakey Lee got it. We missed it by 2 weeks. And so Mark was going, oh, well. So he goes, somebody will call. Don't worry. A few weeks later, Grover Jackson gets a phone call from Paul Stanley looking for some fire. Look, all the hot players are in L.A., wanted some hot player.
Want to get your official Three Sides of the Coin logo and shocker tee? Now you can. We ship worldwide. Get yours online at shop.threesidesofthecoin.com.
Grover gets a call from Paul Stanley.
That is correct. Grover calls me up and says, I got a call from Paul Stanley. You should be getting a call from Glitzman Mark's management. I'm going, great. I go, well, Mark, do you want to audition for KISS? Well, hey, opportunity is opportunity. It's like you were talking last week about with our last interview you did with Vinnie Vincent. I didn't really watch the whole thing. I don't know the thing with Vinnie Vincent, but it's like, it's opportunity. I don't know how Vinnie got the gig with KISS and how he got the audition, so on and so forth. So I got a call from Glickman's Mark's management and said to have me send the bio, the tape, the package. I sent the package. Next day air.
At this time, Mark is still playing the cover circuit and teaching.
Mark can play anything, any cover circuit. Yes, Mark's playing nightclubs. All Mark did for all that I ever known Mark was teach guitar, play nightclubs at night, and it's all top 40. Back in the 80s, that stuff was on fire. It's great. Had a blast. Wish it was still here. Anyway, besides all that,
So you sent the package out to the Glickman Marks.
Don't remember that one of the gentlemen there called me back, and after he goes, would Mark like to audition for KISS? And I go, yeah, Mark would like to audition for KISS. And he goes, well, here's your airplane ticket, the hotel, so on and so forth, the itinerary to make it to New York. Mark grew up in Anaheim, or Garden Grove, and around the Anaheim area, but mainly Garden Grove. Orange County person, never been to New York. I toured with Alan Holdsworth for many years, and New York's kind of a brutal place. If you're from Southern California, a little bit of sunshine, surf, it's a little different. All I can say is it's different. You throw Mark into New York City, it's a jungle. Wow, he's going, wow.
So did he go out by himself, or did you go with him?
Mark went to the audition. I paid Gordon Davis's flight and gave him a bunch of money just to go take care of Mark for the audition. They came back from the audition. Gordon goes, scared the shit out of him. Totally scared the shit out of him. I go, whoa. And I go, that's the way it's supposed to be.
Did you get any, like, what scared Mark? What was...
No, Mark scared...
Oh, Mark scared them.
Scared them.
Oh, okay.
Mark scared the shit out of him. I go...
So what did Mark do that scared him?
Mark went, he was at his peak. That guy is a player. He was just a really all-out guy that performs, but he was a player. And all he did was learn top... He studied Paganini. He was into John McLaughlin, Alan Holdsworth, all the little heavy guitar, Al Di Meola, all that kind of music. Emerson, Lake, and Palmer, yes, you know, fusion stuff. KISS was always part of it. It's just part of a genre of rock. But Mark went out there, and Gordon said, scared the shit out of him.
Did he give you any details as to, like, what songs he – did he have to learn any KISS songs?
They gave him a list of songs, and he was learning them on the plane. And this Mark was a sponge for music. Plus, I'm sure Mark's played all the KISS tunes back in the day. It's like, that was it, man. Back in the day, everybody played that or Deep Purple, or it's just what part of it. So, yeah, Mark
so he showed up
very, very easily.
So he showed up ridiculously prepared, essentially.
What?
He showed up ridiculously prepared and blew him away.
Well, for him to play KISS songs, what they wanted him to do was great. And that was, and I don't remember what he played. And he did this thing at the nightclub called the Norton Bomb, and it was like a guitar solo thing. Incredible. Just wild. So,
and did he have recollections? Was there anybody else out there auditioning? Did he get any feedback from KISS?
It was audition. It was Mark scared the shit out of him. The next day, Glucksman Mark's called and said, would Mark like to be in KISS? That is correct. They sent the contract. It was really meager. I think Vinny's little shenanigans, as I've read or heard or hearsay or whatever, that he really screwed it up for Mark or anybody else trying to get a gig with KISS. You know what I mean? So Mark couldn't even say he was in the, it's like pretty much he couldn't even walk down the street and say, hey, I'm in the band KISS. It's like it was rules and regulations, and it wasn't any large paying gig. It was a side act gig pretty much. So
do you recall how much KISS was paying him? Do you recall the amount in the
contract? I know exactly the amount because I was supposed to get a cut of it, and I had to fight his dad for I pretty much gave it all to Gordon because Gordon worked with him all his life. So for $50,000 to do Animalized double platinum, and what? Mark got kind of reamed on that one because that's a double platinum record. You know, they could have bonused them something, anything. I know that the other guy played on there a couple tracks.
Bruce Kulick, yeah.
Yeah, Bruce Kulick. And yeah, that sounds good, but it's not Mark Norton. It's just not going to be an art. And I'm just talking about where Mark comes from. You can hear that whatever you hear from the East Coast, yeah, everybody was always, I'm just saying this as what I've seen, everybody's always jealous of Mark's, it was his craft, man. The guy was kind of really crafty, man. And he was fast. He wore girls' clothes, stretch pants, stretch shirts. His hair would stand tall. All he would want to do.
I think they had a problem with another guitar player too that did that.
I'm not talking about girl looking. I'm talking about stretch jeans, so he can do somersaults with a double neck guitar along the stage, and he could do splits and stuff like that. He could stand on his guitar. You know, the guy wore. And when I mean girls, it's stretchy clothes.
So it sounds like, in addition to being a phenomenal guitar player, Mark was also a showman.
Mark was the showman. And I get choked up talking about my friend. Sorry. Yeah, he was the man. Anyway, you sent him out to New York. Well, what we want you to do is go jump on a record. Here, we're going to throw you in a studio. We're going to put you in an apartment for $1 million. $1 million a month coming out of your salary, so on and so forth. And you're going, wow, Mark, that's really not very good if they're not going to put you up, you know? So on and so on and on and on. He's out there. He calls me every night from the studios going, they're telling him, slow down. You're playing too fast, too many notes, blah, blah, blah. This guy's crying on the phone. This guy wants to, anybody that gets an opportunity to go play in a rock band, and they called Grover Jackson out of any guitar builder on the planet. You call Grover Jackson asking for some fire, he sent fire. Mark was too hot to handle. Very, very much so. Not just he was a very nice, very shy, very personable guy. Before KISS, after KISS, that's where things start changing, you know.
Well, but let me stop here because I'm curious.
Sure.
Was he still known as Mark Norton when he went out for the interview, and then he changed it to St. John once he became in the band, got into the band, or how did that? What was the transition period with that?
Well, Tom, what do you think of the name Mark Norton? Is that a fine, outstanding name? Is there anything wrong with that name?
No, I don't think so.
Well, they wanted to put dead animal clothes around him and call it Animalize him, call him St. John, just like it was. It's not Vinny Carsunio or whatever his last name, Carsuno, whatever. It's Vinny Vincent. So KISS makes you change your name. Mark St. John. Well, what about Mark Norton?
So KISS was the one that decided to change it to St. John.
Same with Vinny. I don't know about the latest players. The drummer that passed.
Eric Carr.
Well, that's his name, right? Eric Carr, right?
No. Carr is not his given name.
KISS renames all of their players, just like Paul Stanley isn't Paul Stanley. And
so Mark had no input in picking that name. They just gave it to him and said, "This is who you are now."
Mr. Ranvold, I give you $50,000 a year. I own you. Do you understand me?
Change
your
name.
Is Al St. John. That's it. So, no, let's go back to where we were talking about opportunity. You know, it's like, well, Mark doesn't know Gene or Paul, and they don't know Mark, but they just asked for what they got what they asked for. And that was great. Mark went out there and had a really hard time with, there was a lot of tension in the studio.
Had Mark ever recorded an album prior to this? Had he been in the studio and recorded an album with any band?
Mark's done some little sessiony stuff. Mark was really good with electronics, and with a lot of help from Alan Holdsworth helping us out on a lot of different things, just some outboard gear and stuff, and Mark was great. Mark could punch in and out of anywhere. The engineer over there at the studio in New York loved Mark. Mark was great. There was a lot of tension versus Gene Simmons out doing a movie and Paul not being there all the time, and it was just him and Eric and this and that, and then no bass playing, and hey, I play bass. There he is. He's playing bass on the record. You know, whatever you can get out of him, or, you know, whatever you can get out of the guy. And this person played the bass. That Mark called me and goes, I'm playing all these bass things, and Gene's not here. He's out doing the movie. And then he gets this really kind of attention-y thing with Paul Stanley because Gene's not there doing a movie, and then this and that and on. It's like, it was, hey, pull this guy out of California. It's like, I remember Mark moved Lock, Stock, and Plectrum to New York City from, you know, Garden Grove. You know, it's like jumping into the fire. You know, it's not going to be easy to go work with some major rock stars since you have no experience of New York City. Or the studio thing was okay for him because he's a player. We just spent a lot of time, money, and recording and recording and recording and recording. So for him to go jump into New York and record, that was pretty much easy for him. And it was just not easy working with half the band there and half not the band there.
Yeah, because he really kind of fell into the KISS world at one of their most tumultuous times. I mean, things were really, you know, Ace had left, then Vinny left. The band was not at their peak anymore. They had taken the makeup off. You know, Gene was going Hollywood. Paul was trying to keep KISS alive. And here's Mark, the new guy. Well, I'm sure in his head he's like, do I side with Gene? Do I side with Paul? Who, if I side one way or the other, do I piss the other guy off? How do I keep peace?
Well, Mark just wanted to play guitar. Mark wanted to go play in front of the kiddies. We want to make the kiddies jump, and that means Mark going out playing guitar. And Mark got ill. Mark got this thing called writer syndrome, and it which I read from, it's not taking care of gonorrhea or venereal disease. That's how it comes about, and that's possible. You don't know. But people say, well, is Mark really sick, or did he just out of the band? No, Mark's fingers were as round as quarters. Mark couldn't play guitar. Mark had big problems with his hands.
Now, when did that occur? Was he done with all of his recording for the Anomalize album and then it happened, or did it start coming in while he was recording?
After he recorded. After he recorded, when you look at some of the promo shots of these posters, you can look at Mark's fingers. They look kind of chunky, you know. Mark did the album with ease, no problem there, you know. Not saying with ease, his playing and his knowledge of music, and hey man, he can punch in and out of any board. It's not a problem doing the studio thing for him. It was just, hey, it's kind of like you're like a little local home guy and you jump into this big major band. You don't know anything about, you know, arena rock, or, you know, and like you said, the tension that, and between those two, it's like Mark didn't really play any side. He just wanted to play guitar, as I said. But when you were saying that KISS was like out, kind of like on their way out kind of thing, and they're fighting to keep it together, well, the best quote I've read anywhere about Mark was, it said, Mark, this is Time Magazine, 1984, the review of Anomalize. Mark St. John single-handedly lifts KISS out of the doldrums and back into the forefront of rock and roll. Awesome.
So Mark St. John saved KISS.
So, and it's kind of like, no, it's really hard to talk about Mark sometimes because he really was a larger than life. He didn't have to put on makeup or cat's animals or anything. Mark was just an incredible guitarist, musician, and performer.
Was Mark also a songwriter? I mean, had he written songs before? Did did he contribute any, other than playing parts on Animalize, did he try and contribute writing-wise?
I'm sure Mark wrote a lot of parts. I'm sure, I didn't ask him to write parts. Paul Stanley wasn't there very much. It was mainly Eric and Mark shoved in a studio, you know, and try this, try that, do that. I don't know why they left Mark off the two tracks and had Bruce come in. And it's like, well, what's that about? And that kind of bummed Mark out. It's like, what's that really going on, you know? So that was a lot of weird stuff going on there. But
what was the relationship between Mark and Eric?
You know, I really don't know. He says Eric was a cool guy. I heard what you guys said last time. I can see Mark saying that. You're just a drummer. What the fuck do you know? Kind of crap. I can see any. That's a musician thing, you know. Musicians behind walls can say anything, you know. Yeah, you stink today, you asshole. You know, it's like studio, man. Especially when you're a lot of tension in the air, you know. Plus, Mark was always the band leader, you know, one of those things. And it was always with his brother, and his brother always played bass, and he taught his brother bass. So it was always him and the Nortons, you know.
So he was coming from a world where he was used to leading the band, going, and then he goes into KISS where don't think you can lead anything. You're just doing what you're told.
That is correct. Mark didn't want to change or do anything other than go out there and fly his fingers is what he wanted to do. He, you know, it wasn't like, hey, when I grow up, I want to be in the band KISS. You know, it's like I've played and listened to every one of their songs. I know I got every little piece, part, goodie, whatever, great. I want to be in KISS. No, it's opportunity. It's like, well, KISS isn't really Mark's forte, but Mark can play KISS all day upside down, backwards and forwards in his sleep. And he can do somersaults in it. They should have really let Mark do what he did best and shine. It's not about outshine. And here's our new little monster we just fucking got from sunny Southern California. Watch this guy go. People will be going nutty. So he wasn't out to upstage the band, and he wasn't running things. But when he was in the studio, he was left there do it. So a lot of stuff he did.
Was he kind of scratching his head to the concept of
okay.
KISS calls Grover Jackson to get this hot guitar player. He comes out, he auditions. They see exactly what he's like, obviously, during an audition. And then when it comes to the studio, they're like, okay, now we don't want that. I mean, was he like going, what's going on here?
He just did what he could do. And he was going at it full board. You know, it's like you see a couple, I don't know, I watched some of these when he first got the gig with the band, I think there's a video clip of him in Australia or something, or not in Australia, it was from some Australian publication or some sort of thing. And there's going, yeah, and they're talking to Mark, and Mark's really laid back, going, yeah. And Mark is just a laid back person, man. He was really quiet, very, very nice guy, a gentleman. The women just, you couldn't. Mark was really the woman guy, you know, and he, the best thing he liked to do was turn him away because he's too busy playing his guitar. He let a few of them in the door, you know, but that was his thing. Guitar was his life. He played banjo. He was a picker. I got some of the demos that I like sent to KISS. Get Mark playing lead banjo, picking in there, you know. Mark was anything with strings, mandolin, guitars, electric 12-string, anything. Mark was guitars.
What songs were on the demo that you sent KISS for that audition?
All original. There's a couple. Since we were trying to do the Randy Rhoads thing, we went to this Orange Studio thing, and he started doing all these Randy Rhoads guitar and things, guitar type runs and chords and stuff.
Do you still have that tape? What?
Do you know I still have this tape, and it's got 18 unheard cuts. And I just had it maybe last year, put it through a Fairlight off of a cassette tape, which it was on one of these old Maxell metal tapes. It's actually metal, you know, so it was a high-end tape. It's got, wanted to put it out and thinking about it. I'm going, you know, I don't know, you know, but it's kind of like, it's going to be some money and effort. And it was just going to be called like the, the Norton tapes or the, it's something like that. But there's a really a lot of great guitar playing on there. And it's all the different studios and different guitar playing, a little jazz, a little bit of everything.
And even you should put that out.
You know, I should.
I have somebody that would absolutely love the artwork. Yeah.
I don't know if people want it. I'm not selling very many White Tiger CDs. I'm sure anybody of the KISS people that really want it have it. And it's not. I still have a website up just because of Mark. It costs me $300-some a year to post it. I sell 3 to 10 CDs a year. And other people that get them from me sell them for $50. You know, I'm going, well, that's not right. But that's the way it goes.
So, hey, Eddie, I'm going to ask you a quick question about those about the session, the Animalize session. I recall reading once that Gene and Paul, again, with the tension of between them, that they were in two different studios recording Animalize, and that they would actually ask if each one of them was done recording with Mark.
You know what? You are correct. I do remember Mark saying he went to two different studios. But, see, we're talking 20-some-odd. We're talking a long time. I can't remember everything, but you are correct.
Lisa? This is why we have her on.
Exactly.
This is why she's on.
I mean, that had been
They weren't getting along. They weren't getting along, and Mark was in the middle of it, you know, but Mark just wanted to do his thing.
Again, it was an opportunity. It was an opportunity for him. But that had been very frustrating to just be pulled in two different directions all the time, especially coming from such a creative background that he had. He just wanted to play his music, not being bounced back and forth, you know?
Well, the same thing. How did Vinny get the job? Who found Vinny, or where did Vinny come from, or where did Eric come from? They got to come from somewhere, you know what I mean?
We're still looking for the guy who brought Vinny into this world, because they need to be slapped.
See, I don't know the background of Vinny at all, other than Mark followed it and he did the song "Lick It Up" that played all over the radio, and I thought he was like a really ugly guy, and he was also a friend of Grover Jackson's because he played that Randy Rhoads model that Grover did, you know. And I didn't know Vinny. I went and saw him open up for 10 Minutes Till Midnight band. What's that?
Iron Maiden.
What's that?
Iron Maiden. Vinny opening for...
Yeah, they were opening... In Vinny Vincent's Invasion, they were opening up for... Trying to remember the name of the band. Bruce Dickinson.
Iron Maiden,
yes, correct. I watched Vinny, and it was just okay for me. It was just like, all right, just... You got to have hits, man. Hits are everything. If you don't have hits, you don't got nothing. You're just a bunch of sound, you know. Then Dickinson came out, and I go, oh, that's terrible. I left. But anyway, no, I don't know Vinny's back.
Did Mark ever say anything about, you know, somebody sitting down and say, okay, this is what happened with Vinny. Don't do this or you'll be gone too?
It was all in the contract, my friend. You can't do this and you can't do that. I'm sure there...
We got to see this contract.
What's that?
We need to see this contract.
I don't know where it's at. I wish I did. So, yeah, you know... That's what it was. From listening, it's like, why is it so important that you see it? Or, I mean, it's just like...
It's just, you know, because you know, in my mind, I'm sitting here going, all right, like, and you sort of said this, they learned their lesson with Vinny, and they probably doubled down for Mark to make sure that everything's going to be in the contract.
It was complete control, my friend.
Yeah.
I don't think that Mark had any kind of creative
input,
any kind of creative measures whatsoever. I think that his restraints were so tight that he couldn't be creative at all. I think that Gene and Paul basically wrote every single solo that he had to play, because I don't even think he was able to have any kind of publishing rights or anything. I think he was so constricted to what they told him to do.
When you start playing bass lines for somebody else's music, you're being creative right there. You're playing bass lines. If Gene Simmons was playing those songs, Mark played the bass line, Gene would be playing Mark's bass lines. See how that works? So, yes, he had creative control. He was playing bass lines. He might not have the control of the whole song or whatever, but when you're doing bass lines, you never know how much chords did he play on that thing and what chord. And what that chord, Paul, that's wrong chord, or I really don't know. I'm not sitting there on that. But when you're saying being creative, when you're playing bass lines and songs, you're being creative. It's pretty creative right there.
I meant it more of like letting him do his own thing as opposed to Gene and Paul telling him, you know, slow it down a little bit, make the solo like this, don't play this, you know what I mean? Like more constraining his creative freedom. No.
Play slow like Jeff Beck. Play way too right. Many notes. Play like Jeff Beck.
So he's
Mark's crying on the phone.
That's what they would say to him is play like Jeff Beck.
Slow down, play like Jeff. Jeff Beck was one of the things. It's like back in the 80s, it was Guitar Wars, wars.
This just baffles me. It's like they're telling Mark to play like Jeff Beck, yet they audition and they hire a guy who is completely not like Jeff Beck.
Well, of course. I didn't understand that. If my partner Gordon says they scared the shit out of him, they scared those guys in New York. Mark put on the whoop ass, man, and showed those New Yorkers, because here he is flying to New York, never been there. I don't think he's ever been on an airplane, you know. So here he is, you know, going out there. He put on a show, I no doubt. But anyway, the whole thing about it was sad. Was Mark got sick, and on and on and on. Mark was kind of happy. It was kind of like, after all the tension he went through and played did what he did, it was like, I just took a big dump when he came home. Well, but his hand was messed up. You know,
to the best of your recollection, though, how much time transpired from the time that they finished the record to when he started to have his health issues?
I really don't know. It was not during the studio. It would not have anything to do with his playing. But when it got to start to go do the tour, that's when his problems were happening. So that's where it stopped, you know. I wasn't there to say, hey, Mark, let me see your hands today or this or that. Or, you know, hey, what did it start? You know, I didn't have that kind of info.
So what kind of feedback were you getting from Mark when they started the tour rehearsals and tour production? Was he talking to you about what was going on in that time frame?
I don't think he didn't really talk that much about it, and I don't think there was that much really rehearsal that I could ever remember. Like I said, Lisa brings up stuff, and hey, man, that is correct. I don't remember everything to be in real detail, but I love to remember everything, you know.
When did Mark first mention that he's not going to be playing on tour?
It was a weird phone call. I'm coming home. I'm going, what? You're coming home. And it was his hand, and he's swelling, and he went to some specialists back there, and he knew it back there. He went to see specialists there. He came home to see other specialists here, like, okay, let's figure out what's wrong with his hand, you know. And his knee and his ankle and his hip swelled up, and they figured out what it was. It was Reiter syndrome, you know. So that was the big clinker for Mark. He couldn't make the tour, you know. So I don't see where they all of a sudden brought Bruce Kulick in, if he's got Bruce Kulick in the studio. You know what I mean? Yeah, Bruce Kulick plays a little bit slower and laid back, more like Jeff Beck, I'll say. Not being anything personal, but yeah. You can't slow. Mark is just a little animal. You just couldn't stop him. He's a little wind-up crazy doll, you know. He just goes, you know. And he's going to play musically everything right on one every time. Everything's perfect. The guy's great, but I think he was threatened by he threatened Gene and Paul by just being, no, Mark, you can't go over to the side of the stage and do your guitar solo. You know, you're not going to cage Mark. You know, there was just no way of caging Mark. And he was really an athletic guy, and he liked to move, and he just couldn't stand there and just be a, you know, a doll, you know.
Let me ask stand you, right was, there. Was it within Mark that he was deliberately trying to be that way on stage, or was it just it was impossible for him to restrain himself?
Oh, I'm sure there was. But he only did like 1.5 gigs or 2 gigs, so he didn't have that much time to get any kind of restraint or do this or learn anything, because he was gone. You know what I mean? After what I think, what, 2.5 shows? I don't, 2.5 shows, whatever it was.
We were told that he played we were told that he played one full show and then a half of a second show.
Something
and I don't
like
know if that's
like
accurate
said,
or not.
Shows. And they had Bruce coming in and off the stage.
When?
Oh, and then I think David Snowden sent me a picture, or somebody sent me a picture of, I think, Bruce and Mark both on stage. Anyway,
that was
a little bit weird for Mark.
When it became clear that Bruce was going to be touring and Mark wasn't, did Mark start to get the feeling that he was being pushed out of the band, that his time was over?
I don't know if he felt like that.
Or did he feel like that once my hand is better, I'm back in?
There was a possibility that he's going to go back out if they could fix his hand, but they couldn't. His hand took him a year for his fingers to get back to normal. After a year, that's when we started White Tiger. Well, a little bit later, but we started rehearsing and doing White Tiger, not necessarily recording it, but at the same time, it took a year for him to get normal. You know what I mean? So there was no way Mark was going to be out on that studio or out on that tour anytime soon, you know?
So again,
I think Mark was happy. I think Mark was very happy to go out and play on that album. It's a double platinum album. It's probably more. And I know Kiss has a lot of records out, but if you look at how many are double platinum and Mark being on one of them, that's pretty happening by me. So that's a, you know, it's accomplishment. And for me, grabbing the guy out of the nightclub is accomplishment. Did I make any money? No. Did I lose lots of money? Yes. Is it about money at this point in the game? No. That's why I have those 18 tracks. Is it about money? No. Do I want to really do it? It's possible, but it's just like, how much interest can I really get over Mark's demo? It's really good. If you're a guitar player and you like guitar music, it's great. If you're a Kiss fan, it might not be your cup of tea.
Well, I think it might be your cup of tea. I think Kiss fans will love it for the simple fact that it's Mark St. John and he was in Kiss.
Oh, yeah.
That's it. That's it.
That's what I was thinking. You know,
do you remember when Mark called to say he was officially fired?
Well, I don't think he was like, he just couldn't. It's call. Are you on or you're not? Either you're with it or you're not. Mark wasn't with it. Mark had writer syndrome disease. He could not make the tour. At that point, they were going straight to Europe, I do believe. Well, they played a few here, and then they went to Europe or something. They didn't do many U.S., and I think it was some European tour they were going on. I can't really remember again. But anyway, he just wasn't going to make the tour, man. His fingers were around his quarters.
But
you know?
I mean, at least the story that fans were told was Bruce was covering the tour while Mark was getting better, but eventually Mark didn't get better. Kiss fired Mark St. John and hired Bruce Kulick. So there had to have been a moment where Gene and Paul said,
"I'm not going to say we fired you because you had writer's in and we had to move on. I'm sorry, we laid you off. You know what I mean? You can be laid off a job, or you can get, dude, you're cut, dude. We're tired of your crap. No, Mark had a health issue. You know, so I can't call it a firing. And what see stuff like that. What I'm hearing back from you is just like, well, I can't call it a firing from anybody. Man, the guy had a health issue. You know,
well, no,
he was replaced.
He definitely had, but there had to have been a moment where they said, Mark, you're out of the band. You are out of the band. You are no longer in Kiss.
Do you believe you could make the call? We're going to pay it off. They paid him off. They just paid him off the rest of his whatever he got from that contract, and that was it. And actually, Mark in the long run was I think he was happy. Like I said, he goes, it felt like I took a big dump, and I felt like, you know, he's home. You know, you go to New York City, you don't know anybody. It's the jungle. It's really hard for anybody, but all he wanted to do was the opportunity to go show his shit. Just like any guitar player out there playing right now, anywhere USA, anywhere on the world, playing lead guitar, they want to be in Kiss. They want to be in any major rock band they can go out and rock in. It's like Twisted Sister. I want to rock, you know.
Did Mark
was happy.
I was going to say, did Mark have any further contact with any of the guys in KISS after he left?
No. No, there's people I heard Gene talking about out there saying, yeah, he's a drug addict. Mark was on dope. Mark was, yeah, but you don't go run around. Why don't you try and help the guy instead of putting the guy down? You know what I mean? It's like, there's some things I can say about KISS that I wasn't really happy with, but as a full, they gave my friend an opportunity of a lifetime. Did he make any money? Was it winning the lottery? Absolutely no. Mark went out on that tour and did all that touring. He's still getting $50,000 a year. No concessions, nothing, zero, zilch. How much money does KISS make on concessions? Let's not even talk about it. Do you get any of it? No. Is your picture on all of it? Yes.
Mark once said that he never even got royalties from that, from Animal Eyes.
What's that?
Mark once said that he never even got royalties from Animal Eyes.
He's not going to get any royalties because he has no writing credit.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he's got quality, he's just a hired gun.
Right, and they wouldn't give it to him.
So, and he had no points on the record where they're going to pay him a percentage with the record sales. He got $50,000. That's your salary, and you're going to pay for your own $1 million hotel and or apartment in Manhattan or wherever it was. I went out there on an Alan Holdsworth tour, and I went to his apartment. He snuck. He's not even supposed to have his girlfriend there from. He's not allowed to have his girlfriend there from California. She's not allowed. She's not allowed. Mark flew her out there, and she was at the apartment.
So, not allowed because of the rules in the contract with KISS?
Mark can't have his girlfriend living out there. Sorry.
Even though he's paying for the apartment himself.
Yeah. He can't know that. So I went out there on a Holdsworth tour, and Mark's in the goes, I'm going to take a shower. If Gene calls and he wants to go to the Alan Holdsworth tonight, let him know, you tell him you put him on the list. Phone rings. It's Gene. Hi, Gene. Eddie, road manager with Alan Holdsworth. Yes, I understand you want to come down to the bottom line. How, you plus one, great. Put him right up front. As soon as he walked in, drinks, had him taken care of. It's great. Gene and his girlfriend Shannon, they were nice people. They come backstage. They tell Alan Holdsworth. He tells Alan Holdsworth, if you ever need anything, you call me. Really great time, great thing. Gene was an all right guy. I mean, you know, when you get really rich and eccentric, man, it's not like you, me, because I know all three of you people here, not millionaire eccentric people. Or we wouldn't be sitting here. No, but so money changes
contrary
everything.
Contrary to what a lot of people believe, we are not millionaires, nor are we making any money from KISS. We don't even get 50 grand.
But we can have our girlfriends in our houses.
You have a girlfriend?
Yes.
Wow. Busted.
Anyway, Mark was kind of happy to get away from that. You know what I mean? Be able to set his name in stone, do the record, and get out of there. First off, he couldn't make the tour. And then after like 6 months, it still wasn't like ready to go. So obviously we're going to replace him and say, hey, I'm sorry, we got this other guy going. He's on the tour, blah, 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 blah. We're going to buy him out. Here's your money. Boom. Sign it off. Bam. Said, okay. Mark's sitting there going, well, I need to make the money. You know, they just bought him out. So that's the way it was.
When Mark left, were there stipulations? Was he able to promote himself as Mark St. John, formerly of KISS?
He was supposed to not. He was supposed to not ever say he was a KISS. Like, I got him this endorsement with G&L Guitars, which was George Fullerton, Leo Fender. It was a shoot off of was what Leo was doing because he didn't own Fender anymore. So Leo was building some guitars for Alan Holdsworth, and I was working with Alan. I says, hey, Leo, you want to do some guitars for Mark from KISS? So we did this photo shoot and the whole thing, and we put out this ad. It says, Mark St. John or Mark Norton, I think we put it. Mark St. John, formerly a KISS. KISS says you can't say of KISS, but you can say Mark St. John. They gave him the name. You know, what are you going to say? Now I can't be Mark St. John, but they can't say. So they made all these stand-ups for, like, music stores. They had to destroy them all and take off formerly of KISS. So they wouldn't let him do that. You know, come on. Anyway.
So when did the thought of White Tiger become?
Bring that by me again, my friend.
When did you start talking about White Tiger? When did that start to give? You know, when was that born?
Mark's hand was better. What are we going to do? Blah, blah, blah. Let's start a band. Okay. Another friend of mine had a stint with Black Sabbath. He did all the promo stuff. He did all the rehearsing. He did the whole spiel. Magazines, everything. Warner Brothers dropped Black Sabbath. He lost the gig. He was a good singer, great singer. Well, it's up to whatever you guys thought. He was a great singer. Still is a great singer. Talked to him the other day, actually. And so I go, Mark, let's do a band with you from KISS and singer of Black Sabbath. And Mike on bass. So there's this other Orange County drummer guy, Brian Fox, rolls around the same circuit of the nightclubs. Just the showman. He was the showman, sets the sticks on fire. The guy was an excellent showman, drummer, the look, everything. That's what we wanted. Mark said no. What do you mean no? I guess he was with one of Mark's ex-girlfriends. I go, that's BS, Mark. Anyway, I fought him and fought him and fought him. Brian was in the band. Me and Gordon was my partner, and he's the sound man where I met Mark at the nightclub. Been with Mark for a long time. He's going, we need to make a, you know, name of a band. So it was kind of like a two-syllable thing. It was like either Led Zeppelin is one, you know, that sort of thing, or Van Halen. It's like, how about White Tiger? Well, we didn't know about White Lion or Glass Tiger or any of this other stuff going on. We're going, oh no, what do we do? Anyway, besides all that, that's how it came about. And David Donato wrote some songs, had some lyrics, and started putting it together.
Was there any major label interest in the band, considering the two big names that were in it?
So we did our showcase at the Reseda Country Club. Sold it out. Before the gig, I called every major label, told them my name is Eddie Coralnick with Mark St. John, formerly guitar player at KISS. Would you like to come to our showcase? Sent out invitations to all these places. They all showed up. Paul Gilbert and Racer X was the opening act. Mark didn't show up to sound check. It's 9:30. We go on at 10:30. Where's Mark? He's out playing rock star, partying. Every major record label was there. Mark really screwed up. Paul Gilbert came out and reamed him a new one. I don't know if you knew who Paul Gilbert is in Racer X. Really hot LA band. Really hot player. Paul Gilbert, great guy, great player. Anyway, that was one thing. We got lots of interest to come to that thing. Couldn't get anybody to go. You know, just don't know. So that's where that went. I mean, we did a little bit of touring. We did some shows. It was great. Then it got tension between Mark and the singer. So that's where it started getting. Hey, if anybody knows about, want to know about managing a band, just don't do it. It's really, working with people is really hard.
Now, when you
especially
talk,
when there's a little ego.
When you talk,
you know, I'm from Black Sabbath and I'm from KISS. You know,
well, I was going to say,
well, I don't care who the fuck you're with.
So where was the tension coming from? I mean, was there some tension from Mark saying, this is my band, I'm the star?
Mark, I think it's all Mark. It's all on Mark. I hate to say that, but it's pretty, well, it's all on Dave too. Because Mark would set it off and Dave come, there was no stopping, you know. What being in KISS did to Mark really changed him as far as like, well, you're on a double platinum record or whatever, on and on and on and on, and everybody wants to be your friend. Everybody wants to take you to dinner, drive you anywhere, do whatever you want. So all of a sudden, the management company, me and Gordon, or the record company, hey, we're gone. You know, it's like, well, that was then. Now it's me. You know, that's when he started going out doing, I don't know, all these different projects and stuff like that. And he was into a lifestyle that I was not into. So I pretty much was working out doing Alan Holdsworth. White Tiger was over. I'm not going to go chase Mark to go do work with Peter Criss or any of this other stuff. White Tiger was over. Dude, I was spent. I did that whole getting Mark into the KISS thing and the whole White Tiger band thing. And it's pretty taxing, you know. It's not an easy task.
It seems
had a lot of fun. Don't regret any of it.
It's interesting to me that, you know, you talk about how Mark got thrown into this big band, dealing with the tensions that were going on in KISS, how he was happy to be out of it when it finally ended. And yet when he came out of it, he kind of took all that baggage and troubles with him into his new band.
I'd say Mark was really bummed at himself about a lot of stuff. And I think when he came back from KISS, people were kind of going, oh, you know, still he's on that record playing all over the radio here. The Heaven's on Fire was all over this SoCal thing, you know. But I think he was kind of like, he was the local guy going into the big band. And then when he got out with the Hell thing, and then he isn't KISS anymore. And then we do the White Tiger thing. And that was pretty cool. I sold 50,000 copies out of my apartment, you know. So it was
pretty impressive.
I had a two-bedroom apartment, you know, so I sold a lot of product, you know, and all I had to do was call up the record company and ship to the different places, and they'd be buying lots of records. So it was kind of cool. It was a lot of fun, and it is riding on the curtails of KISS. There's just no doubt. I can't say anything bad about those guys. Those guys are those guys, and we guys are us guys, you know. No matter where we are and where they are in life, I'm not going to ever be anywhere near their limo driver makes a lot more money than I, you know. I can't say that, but I'm just saying, you know, hey, it was an opportunity. He took it and ran with the ball. Here's the ball. Hey, he's a basketball player. Here's the ball. What are you going to do, Mark? Going to put it in the hole. So he went out to do a job, and he went out and do a job. He got ill, and it's really sad that he couldn't make those tours. But he could find out in a day and a half. I think the first day he wanted to go out there and play lead solo guy. You know, you hired me to play solo lead guitar players. They jumped down his neck, and he called me. And, I don't want you ever to do that ever again. And rah, 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 rah. And he was kind of going, wow. It's like, well, am I just going to be the wind-up doll? I'm going to put in the cupboard and everything. You can't use my name. You can't do this. It's just like, I think Vinny ruined it for the next guy really bad. But
I almost wonder if it was like Jake E. Lee when he stepped in after Randy Rhoads had died. The same kind of thing. It was almost like you're destined for failure because of what came before you.
I would say playing-wise with Jake E. Lee, I don't know about any of his working relationships and what his deal was with them.
Nor do I. I'm just saying, just from outside looking in, it's like it because of the greatness of Randy Rhoads, it made the next guy's job almost impossible. And because of the insanity of Vinnie Vincent, it made the next guy's job impossible. Because it'd be interesting to see if there wasn't a lapse between Vinnie and Bruce, if Mark had not been part of it, would things have been different, or would Bruce have just been like, I can't do this, you know? Or if Mark had not gotten ill, do you think Mark would still be in the, would have stayed in the band considerably longer?
Oh, I do believe it's the opportunity. I wouldn't leave it. He's into a contract, so he probably couldn't quit the band. You know what I mean?
But if they got rid of him,
they have to buy him out, obviously.
Eddie, let me ask you though. So to Tommy's question, if Mark hadn't been ill, would Mark have been able to restrain himself on stage and not be the flashy lead guitarist that Gene and Paul did not want him to be? Or was it just impossible for him? Because to me, it sounds like that's what it's going to come down to. Can he
conform?
Can he just be the quiet guy standing off to the side?
We go back to it. He played one and a half shows. I'm sure after some amount of time, he would be like I said, he needs to be trained what to do in the major arena rock band. You just can't. Well, if you don't tell him what to do, he's going to do what he does.
But what I'm asking you is,
I realize what you're saying.
Based on knowing his personality, could he have done that? Because it seems like Vinny wasn't able to do that. Vinny knew he needed to do that, never could do that.
That's, when you start touching on Vinny, I know nothing about Vinny and Vinny with the band. And when I start listening to you on the last interview or the last panel thing you did with David Snowden, it was all this chop on. I didn't hear the chop, but it was kind of snub Vinny. I don't know Vinny to snub Vinny, and I don't know why he's being snubbed. So I'm kind of illiterate when it comes to, well, Vinny didn't want to, you know, I don't know what Vinny did on stage.
But what I'm saying is we as fans have learned that one of Vinny's big issues was he would go up there and try and upstage Gene and Paul, and he'd want the solo and he'd want the attention and the spotlight. And Gene and Paul would tell him, you can't do that. This is not about you. This is about the band. And that clearly was something that never got resolved. And
Mark got that on the very first night, on the very first show. So, yes, I do believe that bled over. But, see, like I said, I don't know about there. So, if Vinny was like that, it's like, hey, I'm a lead guitar player. What do? I play lead guitar. If I'm a flashy guy, I'm a flashy guy. You know, and like I said, like Mark went out there and showed him his shit. They hired that. You hired that? Yeah, we hired that. It came in there and smoked. Mark's a great player, a great guy. I think Mark would have conformed to it if he got a taste of what it's really like and how cool it is to be a rock star. Sure, I'll do whatever you want, sir. Yes, sir, no, sir, but he has no idea. He's played one night and he's been grabbed, thrown in the studio, and now we're going to rehearse and now we're going on the road, you know. After 1.5 nights, you have no chance to learn that rope. You know, he's got to learn the ropes. Yeah, we're going to learn the ropes with you. And yeah, Mark, I think on this song, we're going to let you shine over here. Let's do the Norton bomb you told me about. And you did, you know, the solos thing. You know, he had this really cool solo thing going. Anyway, besides all that, I do believe Mark could have conformed just like I said. Well, yes, sir, no, sir. You're my boss, of course. But at the same time, it's like Mark didn't get a chance, like I said, learn the ropes of arena rock. You know what I mean? And that's what it is. You know, hey, any lead guitar player, I can say Alan Holdsworth, hottest thing going, stands in the shadows. You know, there's that guy, and then there's the guy that wants to leap. Back in the early 80s, they came out with an affordable wireless for guitars. In the earliest, couple grand was too much for me to buy it. So it got affordable. I bought Mark one of these wireless. He was all over these nightclubs. It was really fun. But that's back in the nightclubs days, you know. But now you're sitting on stage. Where are you going to go stand in front of an amp and all night and play in the shadows? But I don't think Mark knew any better the first night to go out and do what not to do. I'm sure they didn't say, well, we don't want you to do this and don't not. I don't know. You know, and so are they going to say on the first night, we don't want you to upstage me whatsoever at all? You're going to hear Gene or Paul say that to you? No, I don't think so. If you do it, we're going to say, don't ever do that again. And that's what Mark said. They said, don't ever do that again. And he goes, all I wanted to do is play guitar. You know, so where do you draw the line being too flashy? Mark could stand in a 2-foot circle and be the flashiest guy and not go anywhere. You'd watch that guy and he would entertain you 2 feet. He wouldn't have to run around. But Mark could conform. Mark could learn. Mark's not stupid. But
so then after the dust settles and his solo band or the White Tiger is done, what happens next? Where does this story go? Did you stay in constant contact with him after point?
I was in contact with Mark, and I was in contact with the guys in the band. Yeah, it just Mark started getting into a kind of a heavy drug problem. Okay, it got to that way. So you couldn't get him away from the people. It's like, it becomes that rock stardom thing. It's all these people want a piece of you and this and that, and I'm going to buy you this and do this. Every girl, this and whatever. Whatever you can imagine is coming at you. You three have never been a rock star, neither have I. Or
Tommy has. At least,
oh, has he?
Okay. Are we still on that now?
Guess what? We're all rock stars. Just don't forget it.
No, it's okay, Mark. Mike is just giving me crap, Eddie. It's totally cool. So what you're saying then is that even if the fame was somewhat fleeting or short term or whatever, because he was a member of KISS, he was on a record, therefore he is a rock star in a lot of people's eyes forever, and then that stuff just feeds into it.
Vinnie Vincent, he's still living off it somewhere. He's still living off that stuff
Trying hard.
You guys don't worry about that, but he's living off that KISS. He's still on there until you're no longer taking in air. The KISS Army is the KISS Army, right? So when you are in the KISS Army, you are in the Army. And when you're a fan, you're in the Army. When you're in the band, you are the Army, I would do believe, or how would you put that? So
he's in the family forever is basically what it comes down to.
Especially KISS. There's a lot of great rock bands out there, but there's only a few that really will just etched in stone. You know, there's only a few super groups out there, and I'm not a huge KISS fan. They wrote some good stuff, and it was popular, and it was fucking party rock, and I love to party, and everybody did all night long. You know, that's just the way it was. You know, the 70s was a great thing, 80s was a good thing too, but that's just the way it was. You know, so I can't take anything away from any of these guys. These guys did a great job with it. Hey, I don't know what kind of person Gene Simmons is personally doing business, or Paul, or these. I'm sure these guys got tough little fangs going on in their heads, man. I'm sure. They're pretty savvy on doing business because they wouldn't be all that rich by just kicking back, you know. So anyway, I don't know these people, and it doesn't really matter. I think if they can still fill arenas, like who's the latest players, the latest drummer and guitar player, how are they doing?
Well, so
I don't even know.
So then once he got into the throes of his drug addiction and all of the things that were going on, and you were saying that you can't get him away from those people. So at some point, were you just kind of watching this kind of somewhat spiral out of control and going, how do I help him? Or, I mean, what was his life like? What did he go back to after all this? Did he go back to playing nightclubs, and was he teaching guitar lessons? No. What was he doing?
Wait, before you answer that question, can I ask something real quick? I'm sorry, Tom.
Sure. No. Go ahead.
That, from what I understand, didn't Mark St. John and Peter Criss have a pretty buddy-buddy relationship at some point?
Yeah, they did a thing with Mark, Peter Criss, Mark's brother Michael, the bass player. So that's always the norm.
The reason I'm asking,
I think it was called The Keep.
Did this happen after White Tiger and before kind of where he got mixed in with this kind of a not so good drug crowd?
I think it went all the way. I don't think the Peter Criss crowd was a good crowd either. It's all not a good crowd.
Well, I understand he like stayed with Peter for a while and basically lived with him, recorded some demos with him
That's what I've heard, but I was not in contact. Just I'd hear from the outside. You know, I was outside looking in. You know, I was done. The music stuff I was doing is I was going out touring with Alan Holdsworth, you know, doing shows, you know, I wasn't.
So didn't know about that part of the.
Oh, no. Yeah. Oh, he also did a thing with the guy from Baywatch. One song he played some guitar on. I don't remember what's the guy's name?
David
guy from
Hasselhoff?
Baywatch. Yeah, he did. Hasselhoff did a track where he was singing and they had Mark.
Don't Hasselhoff.
Yeah. Mark played guitar on it.
I'm sorry. I didn't mean to divert that question, Tommy. You asked about.
No, that's quite all right.
If it's in the mic of my head.
Hasselhoff.
Please ask
right
more.
Yeah,
go
was
ahead,
he rocking
Tommy,
the
your question?
Yeah. So, anyways, no. So, I just wanted to know then. So, what happened next in his story? Where did he go?
Well,
what did he do?
Next,
he went back to L.A. or.
I really lost contact on a lot of it because Mark didn't go. He was hanging out with not so good people. He got into trouble. He ended up going to jail. There's a lot of stuff. He was just, man, the guy was like, well, there goes, you could drive down the street and you could see this guy, this all shriveled up guy riding down the street on a bicycle looking in trash cans. And they go, see that guy over there? That guy used to be in KISS. Man, that guy got down to the very bottom of it. You know, he went, if you saw any of the pictures of him in any of those KISS, those things, like little Kiss shows with all the fans that come there, and you see pictures of Mark all sucked up, looks like he's dead. Well, I can't help anybody like that. You know, it's like Mark wanted to do that. Mark's not listening to his old managers. We have nothing to say. You know what I mean? So at that point, it was like Gordon, my partner, he was out doing something else, and I was out doing something else. It was done, you know. But Mark went out and worked with Peter Criss, and I did some Hasselhoff stuff. This is just all I hear, you know. And he played on this and that, whatever, and nothing's ever came out of it, you know. But that was Mark. And there's nothing to do. He lived in his garage at his folks' house, and it was just wall-to-wall speakers. Everything was speakers and equipment, you know, just – he's back to that same thing, and he still have students come over. But he didn't. I go, Mark, I'd come over there, and it's like, Mark, when are you gonna grow up, bro? Let's do a band again. Why aren't you playing? You could at least be playing. I'd come by there, and I'd knock on the door, and his mom's, oh, he's not here. And she'd start crying. She goes, Kiss ruined Mark. And I go, well, it's every guitar player's little dream that ever wants to be a guitar player. They want to rock. And Mark got to live his dream. Yes. And his mom was just like, she'd rather have Mark living in his apartment, teaching students, playing nightclubs. And
loves her son. But what's that? It seems, I said she loves and cares about her son, but it seems to me that if it wasn't for Kiss, it could have very well have been any number of other bands.
Sure.
And no disrespect to his parents, but it seems to me that a lot of that is personal choice, you know.
She didn't mean Kiss as the band. The rock stardom thing ruined them. Like you said, it could be any other band. It could have been any other band that was a large band.
Yeah, it seems to me the way you've described what happened, you know, and I'm obviously no expert in this, but this is just how I'm viewing it. Mark got a little taste of that superstar arena level mega band, and when that disappeared, he couldn't give up that in his mind mentally. He's like, he still wanted to be up there, but everything about his life meant you got to go back and start from ground zero again. You've got to play the clubs, you've got to hump your own gear, you've got to change your own guitar strings. You don't have roadies. You don't have, you know, you don't have tags.
Believe me, he had all that, bro. I paid them.
Yeah, but that's the whole point. He still wanted that even when he was out of Kiss, when in reality he needed to knock himself down a few notches and go, all right, I gotta work to get back up there again.
Yeah, he needed to lower his I just want to call it. You can call it ego. You can call it one. You know, when you become labeled as that guy from Kiss or that guy was a Rolling Stone or that guy used to be in Led Zeppelin or whatever. And back in the 80s, you know, it was a little more. There was more music to listen to. Now there's no. I don't hear any music on the radio anymore, other than listening to old stuff. And there's nobody new that I've really listened to that I haven't. Nobody's really turned my head to listen like. What's the newest thing to listen to? What's, you know, everybody's that's Kiss fans like, but you've listened to the Kiss records over. I mean, I haven't listened to any Kiss records other than I put on Anomalize a few weeks ago to say, well, I just don't listen. I put on the radio station, they play it all the time, you know. So they still play it, you know.
Was there ever a point post Kiss after he left that he might have looked at auditioning and joining another band? Was there any interest from other bands to say, you come be our lead guitarist?
Not that I was aware of. I think Peter Criss was one of them. The Hasselhoff paid him some good money to come out and play guitar. I think Mark fell away from the whole after White Tiger and that Peter Criss thing. That was pretty much it. You know?
And I'm going to bring up Vinny again, but I wonder if Vinny's solo career kind of bothered Mark, because when Vinny left Kiss, he signs this mega record contract with Chrysalis Records, does two albums, tours, You know, I wonder if Mark's mind was like, why can't I do that? Why aren't they doing that for me? I was in KISS, too.
I think he was also labeled as being having a bad health issue. You know what I mean? So it's like, you know, that was part of it. You know, why isn't he KISS? Because he has a bad health issue. You know, I really don't know. Hey, if there was an offer out there, it would have been really looked at and probably snatched up. No problem. But it is what it is. You know, Mark. I want to say everybody ruined it. There was some weak spots in White Tiger. Management stuff was really hard to manage these four guys and pay them. You know, we paid them a per diem, a weekly per diem, just to keep them going. You know, we weren't rich people. None of us were. Gordon's father put a lot of his savings in there to do White Tiger. And I had some money saved. I had a Porsche and a boat. I sold all that stuff. Let's do a rock record, you know. So yeah. It wasn't easy trying to do it, you know. Just because some band get into some other band, well, what's that going to do? You already got into a band, so.
How many of the White Tiger rings do you still have?
I have none. I bought something off eBay from some guy, and he knew who I was. He goes, oh, I know who you are. I still have one of those rings. I want to try and find my message somewhere and say, hey, if you're going to sell that ring, can you sell that thing back to me? But, we sold a few rings, and it was kind of cool. And it was kind of because I had a friend that was a jeweler. He goes, yeah, let's do White Tiger rings. They weren't very expensive, but they were cool.
Do you want to, here's your chance, because we were talking about, you know, having you on so that you could talk to the listeners and let them know who Mark was as a person. Do you want to go through and discuss any of the rumors? We were talking about that before we started. Do you have anything to say about any of the stuff that you've read that's true, not true, things you want to share with who he was as a person with everybody? Because a lot of fans really don't know anything about him. We've been asked for years, have a show on Mark. And it's like, well, great, but up until finding you, David was the only other person that really had any interaction with him.
Well, like I said, Mark was a really, really nice guy. Really nice guy. He spoke more with his guitar than with his mouth, but he was a big teddy bear. He was the nicest guy, and all he lived for was the strings. He played guitar, and that's all he loved. He loved to play guitar, and he had students up at the wazoo. I mean, it's just like Lanny Cordola was one of his students. He was in Jafria. Do you remember Jafria?
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Lanny, yep. You know, he had a lot of students go do different things. Everybody ended up going somewhere working with Mark, and then Mark goes, well, Mark, do you want to be in KISS? You want to join? He goes, well, it's opportunity. Well, okay, let's go. Let's do this thing, you know. So it was a way to get out of the clubs. He'd been pounding the clubs his whole life. You know, it's like, out of the clubs? Let's go, you know. But Mark was a really nice guy. He got into a position to where he could be a rock star and play the guitar. Where on the record, he got to do what he did. He got to do very little, one and a half shows. There's not much history on Mark other than he was a great guitar player, great showman. I can't say anything bad about KISS. I mean, sure, like I said earlier, they have their own thing, their own problems. Mark just jumped in there and to play guitar. It wasn't as pretty as you think it would have been. And I couldn't say anything bad about KISS. You know, the opportunity, here it is. Just think if he went out and toured and didn't get to play on a record. Record was great. It's etched in stone, you know. Platinum player, double thing with the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. They needed to list everybody that's part of KISS. You know what I mean? That KISS didn't like it, and there's still people going on about it. The other bands, you know, the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. But, hey, Mark was a nice guy, and I couldn't say anything bad about Mark. Mark got into bad situations with drugs, just like many do in the music industry, in the entertainment industry. In the 80s, it was rampant. It was just really rampant. And if you were anywhere around the music thing, you go down to the Rainbow in Hollywood, and they're snorting coke right off the tables. I'm going, well, this is a restaurant, nightclub, or a bar. You know, it's like, hey, it was rampant. It was really bad. Glad it's gone. I'm The only thing I put in my nose since 1990 was my fingers, but that's besides the point. it's just sad that it had to go that way. And the thing about all of a sudden everybody loves me and everybody wants to give me everything and this and that, and it's kind of a weird feeling. After a while, it's like, who's your friends, Mark? But at the same time, in the end, it wasn't very pretty, and it was really a sad thing to see such a great talent go to the wayside. And I think he was really hurt by leaving KISS and losing the big opportunity from a health thing. And somewhere inside, it's like he was a failure. So I think he felt like he's kind of failed in a way. And when he was doing the White Tiger, he was trying to show that I'm still that rock star thing. But I think he just kind of played it a little bit too big, too large, you know, in some instances, you know. And that's what started the whole thing with the band thing, you know. Hey, Mark, we're all equal here. We don't care. Remember, Mark, we're the guys from the nightclubs, remember? You know, so once you get labeled as a rock star, man, I don't need these people anymore. It was kind of like that, but I don't need to be involved with what you're doing right now either. So it was kind of a mutual split. The band split. It was a mutual split. It just kind of fell apart, you know. And there was supposed to be another record, White Tiger 2 record. And me and Gordon weren't, I was doing this Holdsworth thing and this and that. And they were going to do this other thing. I said, you know, I don't even really want to be part of it, you know. And there were some demos out there that got bootlegged, and they're out there somewhere. But there were some new good songs, but never happened.
Let me give you an opportunity here, Eddie. If somebody listening, and believe me, we've got a lot of young new fans who may not really be even aware of Mark St. John or White Tiger. If they want to buy a White Tiger CD from you, where can they go online?
EMCRecords, one word, .net.
EMCRecords.net. Go get yourself a White Tiger CD.
Pretty much email me for a, you know, you can send a check or a PayPal. I've had this thing up since 1990. I haven't done anything to it, not one single thing. A friend of mine put it up for me. It's not about money. I've never sold many CDs off, and I sell to some of these little metal record shops that buy 10, 20 at a time, and that's great, mom and pop shops. I never put it on eBay till recently, because after watching people trying to sell it for $50, I'm going to put it on there for $25.86. You know, or, you know, so it's like,
do you still have any vinyl?
No. There's a few, I have a few pieces. I've got a few autograph pieces. Gordon, he has some vinyl, and I saw him a couple weeks ago, but he doesn't have any CDs. He wasn't part of, I wasn't part of the second White Tiger thing, but they weren't part of the CD. And no, I did that CD from all my friends and doing all the artwork and on and on and on, and nobody had the ambition to do it except for me. Michael Wagner did that remix of Rock Warriors. It's the first track on there. We paid $10,000 for that one track to be remixed. Never got used. Hey, nobody's listening to vinyl or cassettes anymore, so a CD was in line for it, so I put it on a CD. Back in the days when CDs first come out, for a band to put out a CD, we don't have that kind of money. But eventually the other formats washed away, and I was able to do a CD. I've only pressed up a couple thousand, you know, so I still got a few hundred left, and it's not about sales, and I'm not out pushing it. It's always been just about keeping my friend's name alive, you know. Right. And if I take down this website, I'm throwing my own stuff away. I feel bad about it. It can say 1999 on there forever, but it's not going to change. I'm not going to put up a store on there where you can buy it right off the site. Email me, you know. So
yeah.
That's what it is. It's not out of print. I can say that much.
That's true.
Cool. But anyway, yeah, it was a really good thing throughout the 80s and the KISS thing and the Mark. And Mark was really a great guy. Mark got shoved in a bad spot with the KISS thing, with a little bit of the tension between the two players. And, hey, I want to go play guitar. And he did his thing. And, hey, did it 1.5 nights, and that was it. His fingers got swollen. Couldn't play guitar. And that was it. Went to some doctors here, and they sent him home to get better, and it's not going to be soon enough. It wasn't going to be a quick fix. You know, 3 weeks later, okay, it's better. All right, Mark, we're flying you out to the European tour. No, it's like still 6 months later, he's not playing guitar. So it's not it's kind of like a layoff. Didn't get fired. The only thing I think that Mark was bummed about is he kind of, and it was a health issue, and that's one thing, but he's, not that he lost the gig, but I don't know. I don't know what it's like to be a rock star and then not, you know? So
have the rug pulled
hard,
out.
You know?
It's almost like he just had the rug pulled out from underneath him.
That is it. But I can't say anything bad about the band KISS or anything about that or bad about Mark. Mark was a phenomenal player. He lived his life the way it went, and I'm you as all as we are, you know. And everybody tried to help Mark and say, hey, Mark, when are you going to grow up and, you know, get away from this stuff and let's do a band and on and on. We could at least be doing some top 40. You could at least be out of this something somewhere other than sitting in this garage, you know, doing your thing, which isn't very healthy, obviously. Didn't do you much good in the long run. So,
did the KISS fans find him and like show up at his house and knock on his door and shit?
Oh, there was people coming to his house, yes. There was people coming to his house. Yeah.
Leave it to KISS fans.
Yep, exactly. Oh, he won't mind. Let's just go knock on the door.
But yeah, I like I said, it was all really good, you know. It was all experience, you know. Hey, go to a nightclub and find some guy. Throw him in a major rock band. That's... Didn't, for me, it's not an easy task when I go, wow, did I just pull all this off? Well, I think so. You know, but like I say, Animal Eyes is etched in stone, and I really like some of the guitar playing on there. There's some really good stuff, and it's Mark watered down and pulling the reins back on him a little bit, you know, so he got to shine on there. There's no other KISS record that has that kind of guitar thing going on. You know what I mean? It's a different style. It's Mark was a picker, speed picker, man. He used these little teardrops jazz picks, and he had really tiny hands. So it had to be fast and quick. He couldn't be – it's a speed thing, man, and he was a picker. Played banjo really good too. Anyway.
You should have done banjo on Animal Eyes.
Yeah.
We had fire with a twang.
I tried to get this banjo company to put a Floyd Rose at the NAMM show, and they're going, yeah, we can put a whammy bar on a banjo. So we didn't follow through on it, but they said, yeah, we can do that. You know, but anyway.
Eddie, this was awesome. I really appreciate you taking the time to sit down and just talk to us about that era that most of us know nothing about, because it was like the blink of an eye. It was here and gone.
Yeah, it was pretty quick, and nobody knew much other than they slid him in the studio, and he got slid back home, and he had a health problem, you know. And the White Tiger record, there's some really good stuff on there. I can't say the mix is super great, but I'd say there's some really good songs on there, and it's kind of more like a melodic rock, you know. It's not so heavy metal, and there's nothing really demonic on it. It's not about anything. It's all positive stuff, you know.
Yep.
And that's still 1986. What year is it now? So it is what it is. And the only reason I'm here talking is because I can talk for my friend Mark. Because Mark can't talk for himself. And no, I was going to try and have Gordon come over here, the sound guy. But I think he'd get a little excited. He'd start talking about KISS or something. He gets a little excited. So I says, nah, Gordon, I think you better not hang up. Maybe the next one, Gordon.
Maybe. I mean, this was great because, like you said, Mark can't speak for himself now, and there's really nobody else out there who can
I just want people to know that what Mark is. The one thing I want to say to the fans where you read about somewhere, I think some Peter Criss book or somewhere, it says Mark, and they found in Mark's room a bunch of child pornography. That's pretty much slander right there. You're asking for a lawsuit. Mark's no longer around to fight his battle, but you don't be putting in books and magazines that you find a child's pornography in his bedroom. Mark had more women than you know what to do with. So, I don't know. I read that and I was a little bit hurt, but...
Understandably so. You know, because that's
I don't know Peter
Criss.
I mean, you know, I really don't know Peter Criss either. So I don't know what his little. Just don't know. But why would anybody? Why would it? Even if you did see something like that, why would you put it in print? That's a little bit. I don't know. what kind of button are you trying to push? But it's all over. It's all gone. It is what it is. And hey, long live rock and roll.
There you go.
Yeah,
there you
what
go.
Else is there?
There you go.
Yeah, that's
Eddie,
true.
Eddie, once again, thank you so much for joining us. This was a great, almost an hour and a half chat.
All right. Great. Well, I hope you can use some of it. You know.
Oh, definitely. We'll use the whole thing. It was really good.
All right. We're not I appreciate editing. Your time and effort, Mike.
I'll be in touch, Eddie.
All right, then.
Thank you so much, Eddie.
Soon. Hey, all right. Talk to you soon.
Take care. Bye.
We'll be later. Peace.
So first question, Tommy, did you get Lisa on the guest list yet?
That was a very short period of time.
Work your magic.
3 minutes, Tommy. 3 minutes.
Yes, we're working on it, but I'm sure that Lisa will have no problem.
Ooh, aren't you the special person?
No, I didn't say that. I just said I'm sure that Lisa will have no problem. I mean, look at her.
The fact that you can even text somebody to get her on the guest list is pretty special. You rock star.
What would I do without you?
You're just not going to let that. You're not going to let that die. You would be fine without me, Lisa. You've done extremely well for yourself all the way up until this moment. Mike's just going to keep busting my balls.
We have to. There's very little we can bust Tommy's balls about.
At least I got to talk today. That was cool.
It was.
So I thought the interview was really interesting because we just don't know anything about – I don't know anything about Mark. So that was really cool to at least hear some insight of what it was like to know him.
Yeah.
And most of the stuff we do hear is all hearsay. You know, it's all rumors or, you know. So.
Well, yeah. And so hopefully everybody that has been bugging us to do something on Mark is now pacified because – there just is, it's very hard to find people that actually knew him, you know, that we could validate knew him and weren't just, you know, someone that was just kind of a hanger on or a kind of person.
And somebody that knew him through the vast period that Eddie did. I mean, there might have been somebody who's like, oh, yeah, I met Mark backstage at a show or I met Mark in the studio. Well, you know, Eddie was the guy who took the phone call from Glickman Marks saying, does Mark want to audition?
Right.
Eddie put together the tape. I'd love to hear that tape. I don't know about you guys, but I'd love to hear that audition tape. What did Mark send out there to audition? You know, and he's got the phone call saying, we want to hire Mark. So Eddie was there through a lot of this stuff.
Right.
Pretty cool. And I don't know, you know, as we got to the end, I just started thinking, Mark... as Eddie said, Mark was a really, really nice guy, and I think he got himself into a situation that messed with his ego.
Mm-hmm.
He got it.
And then you pile drugs on top of that or any kind of an addiction, it just makes everything worse.
Yeah, you know, he started to get a little taste of that rock star lifestyle, then the rug was pulled out from underneath him. I mean, in the blink of an eye.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't even get to tour the world once. He got to do a couple shows, and that was it.
But also, too, from the other side of the coin, with KISS, it's like you got to keep moving forward. Now you've got a platinum record, and you got a tour. You can't not. So what do? You got to get a different guitar player. And that's why I always have maintained that Bruce was probably one of the best choices for them at the time, just simply because he was dependable and solid, and he was a good musician, and he was a good fit.
Yeah, I think the good fit, definitely, because the more, you know, as we're hearing Eddie talk about how Mark was trying to, for the couple shows that, you know, he even got yelled at by Gene and Paul. You can't do that. You can't act that way on stage. It's like, oh, you know, they don't need a flashy guitar player.
Mm-hmm.
And Bruce is not that kind of a flashy guitar player.
I think he was willing to take that step back.
Well, hence his early nickname, Spruce. As in a tree that he just planted his feet and he never moved.
And he did his thing.
I just love that. That's just, that's awesome.
But you know, I remember when you first heard that nickname, you're like, oh, that's not nice. That's not cool. But now all these years later, after you hear all these stories about Vinny and now Mark, it's like, it makes complete sense.
And they probably needed someone extremely dependable. They needed that more than anything.
Someone
that they could count on.
They didn't have it before.
Well, and I mean, and listen, I'm no guitar expert, but even as Eddie said, Bruce is much more closer to Jeff Beck than Mark St. John is.
Mm-hmm.
And it just seems funny that Paul Stanley calls Grover Jackson asking for the flashiest guitar player, gets recommended Mark St. John. They fly him out there to audition him. He comes in there and he's all flash, blows them away, scares them to death, as Eddie says. They hire him the next day. And then they come into the studio and they're like, okay, now don't play like that. It's like, that's not Mark St. John's problem. I'm like going, what's going through Paul Stanley's head? What's going through Kiss's head when you look for that guitar player and then you tell him not to play that way? What do you think's going to happen?
Exactly. That's what's so odd about that whole thing, because why would you call a guitar company, and especially Jackson, looking for all of the type of guitar players, at least from my perspective as a fan, that played that particular model or brand of guitar were all shredders? You know, Jeff Beck isn't that type of a guitar player. He's, you know, it's a whole different thing. So it's an oddity.
Yeah, it was,
you know.
It's almost like they didn't quite learn their lesson completely with Vinny. They had to do it again with Mark and finally learned, you know what, we don't need a shredder. We need a different type of guitar player, Bruce Kulick.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because Ace isn't a shredder either. He's very unique in his own way, and that's really what they should have done, is gone for another unique guitar player and not chase the trend, because a song is a song, you know? And look at how many bands had guitar players that were absolute shredders that never went anywhere.
Yeah.
You know, that's the thing I think they forgot for a while, is that they still had the ability to write good songs. So, that's my two cents.
Yeah, I think you actually got like a good nickel's worth in this show.
I would say so. I feel like I was actually a part of it. This was nice.
You are part of something you actually created.
Yeah, wow.
Makes you feel good, huh, Tommy?
Mm-hmm. Cool that he's going to be out on tour with White Lion. You know? Lisa will be back.
I wonder if Mark will wear a wig, because the KISS fans would love to talk about that.
Yeah. We know he's going to be playing Wait, you know, and whatever other songs
they had. When the Children Cry.
Yeah.
I don't know what else White Lion
does. Doesn't matter.
Stay hungry.
Yeah. Well, yeah, and somebody actually said, a couple of people said, well, you know, he's replacing the wrong member. It's like,
doesn't matter.
Like, yeah, like, you actually know that?
Really,
you're
getting a little too deep there. Just let it go.
Yeah. Look, the two main guys are there. Does it really matter about the other two? I don't think so.
The fact that you even think that White Lion's getting back together is a... I don't know. You care too much.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We need some homework. Mark St. John related homework.
What did you learn that you didn't know?
What's your impression of Mark after this interview?
Mm-hmm.
What do you think of the guy?
Yeah. I'd say that's a good one.
What's your favorite Mark St. John solo off of Animalize?
Oh, that's a good one.
That's good.
There you go.
That works.
Woohoo!
I hate to say it, but I don't think we'll ever have another Mark St. John show, because there's probably not much more you could talk about.
No, I'd say this is pretty much it. You know?
We have cleared the air of Mark St. John.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Now we need to move on.
Mm-hmm.
This is the segment in the show where you usually ask, what's for dinner?
Right, but we can't do that. And Lisa's going to go see Ace Frehley.
Yep.
How awesome is that?
So, do you even know what you're having for dinner, Tommy?
No, I got to go show houses after we're done tonight. So, popcorn probably. That's about it.
Eat whatever you find in the refrigerator, right?
No, we'll probably sit down and watch a movie when I get home. And Cheryl usually will have, she juices every day, so she'll have a nice big glass of fresh vegetables juice,
you're
and we'll
so
have some
healthy.
Popcorn.
So healthy.
Well, I look very, I'm very healthy compared to like what Izzy Presley eats.
Oh my God.
The other day, he's like, he puts a post up like he went to some place like for a huge burger. And he's like, "Fuck it, I'm already fat."
I was gonna say, did you see his post? Did you see his post where he checked in at a 7-Eleven and was mad that the kid before him got the last pizza? I was like, "What the hell are you having dinner eating pizza from a 7-Eleven for?"
I don't know him that well. But
oh my God!
He's extremely entertaining. Can I just tell you, I'm going off a subject here, but speaking of him, he posted that picture from the Monsters of Rock cruise in that whatever banana hammock thing he was wearing. Oh, I cannot unsee that. I cannot
see
that.
Was it the picture with Tammy Down in the background throwing up?
Yes. I can't unsee that, people. That is now embedded, and I did not. I should have friended him after the cruise because that's pretty bad.
Mm-hmm.
Ooh.
Yeah, he's gonna pull a real Elvis. He's gonna like be eating a glazed donut hamburger on the toilet and
with his banana hammock.
Keel over.
Izzy, oh Izzy, what do you do?
Oh,
I can't believe he has the balls to wear that.
I'm just back to his diet. I get the runs just watching him eat. I mean, the stuff he eats is so freaking greasy. It's just like, it's coming through the internet, and I'm feeling a little queasy right now.
And it's not just one a day. It's like...
That's his dinner every night.
Every day, yeah. You know?
I want to meet him one day.
I'm going to go have sushi tonight.
Well, see,
where are you going? Gas station.
I'm so hungry I could eat a sandwich from a gas station. You know?
Just take it. Take that sandwich from the gas station, the restroom key, and go in the restroom, sit down, and just go straight through.
Yeah. Well, you know, maybe he'll come home for the Minnesota thing, you know?
Oh, that would
I
want to
meet him.
Yeah, that would be
interesting. Maybe he could do an ACK tribute.
Oh, that'd be fun. But see, the problem is with Marty's Place, we've talked about this already, because the KISS Alive, the tribute, 74 tribute that Rick does, they offered to play. But the problem is that I don't know if he'll have a stage by that point.
Yeah.
You know? He's thinking of expanding, so I'll talk to him more about it. You know?
Tommy's our talent coordinator.
Yeah. We'll see.
He's a rock star.
Yeah.
All right. You guys know where to go leave your comments and your homework. Facebook.com/3sidesofthecoin, 3sidesofthecoin.com, YouTube, Spreaker, SoundCloud. Everywhere that we're out there, go leave your comments. We love reading them.
Yeah.
I think that's it.
Okay.
That's it.
Okay.
Woo-hoo!
Wow. We made it through a show without Mark.
Fantastic.
How did you guys do that? I didn't think it was possible.
It's actually quite enjoyable. All right, guys. That's
it. I got to talk. It was awesome.
Tommy got to talk. Got to be part of the show. And Mark has to come to Minnesota if he wants to get one of these. He's probably already got one.
Of course he does.
Who am I fooling?
Yeah, of course he does.
He has 3, 4.
Yeah, exactly. Unopened.
Ooh, let's send him one that's open.
I actually these came in a little plastic sealed bag that I opened.
You got to break the seal.
And threw the plastic bag away. So I could take these out.
Oh, my God. You're so daring.
Mm-hmm. You're gonna get
Watch
in trouble.
Watch this.
Blasphemy!
That's Mark's.
Just lick it.
You should put some like meatloaf in it and send it to him. It'd be pretty rank by the time he gets it.
Yeah. Well, no, it's one of these airtight sealed bags.
Okay.
Double seal. Double Ziploc.
It'll keep it fresh for a while.
Yeah, long enough to get to Detroit. All right, guys, that's it. We're out of here. Next week, Three Sides of the Coin. We're out.
Bye.
For interviews and media inquiries, contact Izzy at izzypresleyproductions.com.
Download your free copy of the KISS School of Marketing.
11 lessons I learned working with KISS.
The number one downloaded business book on Noisetrade. Go to books.noisetrade.com/Michael Brandvold.
You're listening to Three Sides of the Coin.
So you love the show. Go to itunes.threesidesofthecoin.com and leave your review and rating of Three Sides of the Coin. Thanks.